Hello, and welcome to worship on this, the fifth Sunday of Lent. Today is known as Passion Sunday. I'm sorry, that doesn't mean that you are free to go around hugging and kissing people. Government guidelines have not sadly changed just yet. It's because this word passion comes from the Latin word meaning to suffer. It was Jesus's love, his passion, as we now use the word, which led Jesus to his death on the cross. And we are challenged to have that same passion for our faith today. Not just in our relationship with God, in our prayer and worship, but in our serving other people and in sharing with them the good news, the gospel about Jesus. To be passionate in all that we do and say in Jesus' name. To reveal through our lives the glory of God, as we have seen it in Jesus' death and resurrection. May his life inspire ours, and his passion inspire our passion. So, let us worship God. Jesus said, "When I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw everyone to me." In saying this, he indicated the kind of death he was going to suffer. Let us look up to Jesus, raised on high in glory, to save us. We worship God with our first hymn.
Still, for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One, is here. Come bow before him now with reverence and fear. In him no sin is found. We stand on holy ground. Still, for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One is here. Be still, for the glory of the Lord is shining all around. Burns with holy fire, with splendor he is crowned. How awesome is the sight, our radiant King of light. Be still, for the glory of the Lord is shining. For the power of the Lord is moving in this place. He comes to cleanse and heal, to minister his grace. No work too hard for him, in faith receive from him. Is moving in this place. Is moving in this place.
We come to God in our prayers. Loving God, we humbly come to you in worship and thanksgiving. You are greater than we can understand. Open our eyes that we may see the wonderful truths that you have shown us in Jesus. You are more loving than our hearts can respond to. Help us to give ourselves to you in worship, so that we learn what you want us to be. You are wiser than we can know. Still our minds as we worship you, so that we can understand the things you are saying to us. Loving God, in Jesus, you chose to come to the world in humility. You chose the path the world saw as foolish. You used what the world considered weak to achieve your glory. We worship and adore you. Amen. And a prayer of confession. Lord, you call us to serve you, but too often we look after ourselves first. You call us to love as you love, but we love ourselves and not our neighbours. You call us to glorify you, but we seek glory only for ourselves. Loving God, you were obedient, even when obedience led you to the cross. Fill us, we pray, with your love, and enable us to be obedient to our calling. Strip away our selfishness and pride, and open our hearts to your forgiveness. So keep us in your light, that the darkness of evil may not engulf us, so that on our journey through life we may always be children of the light, filled with confidence in your love and power. Amen. I both love and hate John's Gospel. I love it because it is so full of meaning and gives us insights into Jesus and into our own faith, which are deeper, more complex than in any of the other three Gospels. I hate it because I had to study John's Gospel in Greek for my theology degree, and that was very nearly my downfall, failing the crucial exam the first time around. It was a case for me of pan moi Hellenikon, that is, it's all Greek to me. But in studying John in such depth, it opened up a whole new world to me, a world which still feeds my faith and, I hope, inspires my preaching, a world which sets out who this person was, is, and is to be. We're going to listen to three passages from John chapter 12, three readings which take the story on a little bit further each time. These passages contain the preparation for the disciples of things to come. John 12 is set at the beginning of Holy Week, immediately after that triumphant entry into Jerusalem that we will celebrate next week on Palm Sunday. But today it prepares us. On Passion Sunday it enables us to focus our hearts, our minds upon the cross, to think about the sacrifice, the passion of Jesus, and all that he has done for us. So listen to the first of these three readings from John chapter 12.
Some Greeks had gone to Jerusalem to worship during Passover. Philip from Bethsaida in Galilee was there too. So they went to him and said,
"Sir, we would like to meet Jesus."
Philip told Andrew, and then the two of them went to Jesus and told him. Jesus said,
"The time hath come for the Son of Man to be given his glory. I tell you for certain that a grain of wheat that falls on the ground will never be more than one grain unless it dies. But if it dies, it will produce lots of wheat. If you love your life, you will lose it. If you give it up in this world, you will be given eternal life. If you serve me, you must go with me. My servants will be with me wherever I am. If you serve me, my Father will honor you.
The beginning of Passion Tide this Sunday gives us time to think about the cross before we get to that roller coaster of events that will carry us through Holy Week and Good Friday to Easter. It means that we can prepare ourselves to go on the journey to the cross, the journey of suffering with Jesus. It is as if in this passage we are being warned what difficulties lie ahead. It's a bit like a family who are told that someone is ill before they actually begin to show any signs of pain and suffering. So passion in this case means suffering rather than emotion. Although, as we know from stories like Romeo and Juliet, if not from our own personal experience, sometimes the passion of a love affair can result in the suffering of the lovers. The warning that Jesus gives us is that his suffering will become our suffering. And more significantly in this passage, that his attitude to life and death must become our attitude as well. A willingness to give up everything, even our life, in obedience to God. Cannot cling to, that is, we cannot selfishly love, hold to ourselves, our life, so much that we deny its usefulness to God. Rather, if we let our life go and give it to God in discipleship, then and only then will we also gain the gift of life eternal. Going back to that analogy of the lovers, if we continue to be selfish, we might well lose our partner's love. But if we are prepared to give up our own selfish approach of life, then we have a good chance of winning the greater prize of the love that we desire. Jesus said, "Take up your cross and follow me." It's a hard challenge to face, but it's a journey that we must take if we want to be with him in life eternal.
Jesus, to
Jesus said,
"Now I am deeply troubled, and I don't know what to say. But I must not ask my Father to keep me from this time of suffering. In fact, I came into the world to suffer. So, Father, bring glory to yourself."
A voice from heaven then said, "I have already brought glory to myself, and I will do it again." When the crowd heard the voice, some of them thought it was thunder. Others thought an angel had spoken to Jesus.
Then Jesus told the crowd, "That voice spoke to help you, not me. This world's people are now being judged, and the ruler of this world is already being thrown out. If I am lifted up above the earth, I will make everyone want to come to me."
Jesus was talking about the way he would be put to death.
It would be so much easier in life, wouldn't it, if we could always avoid suffering and pain. If we could run away when something threatens us. If we could dodge into the shadows rather than look pain in the face. If in somehow we could avoid all sense of suffering. We often feel when we have to go for an interview, or perhaps to go to a medical appointment, or when we face some challenge in our lives, that we would like to be able to say, "I'd rather not go there. I don't want to face that hour." But we know we not only have to go, indeed we must go, but that it is better to go. To get that help, to know the truth and take the medicine, to have a sense of achievement of something well done after a trial, is very often the good result at the end of a period of struggle and difficulty. Sometimes, with hindsight, we see Jesus' journey to Jerusalem and the cross as inevitable. And this passage follows on from the story of the raising of Lazarus. In John's Gospel, that one miracle tips the balance. And from that moment on, Jesus' fate is sealed. But all along, throughout the story, Jesus does have a choice. He can go on, or he can stop. He can heal. He could even walk away. But no. He chose life for Lazarus, probably knowing that that would mean death for himself. It was his loving care, his desire to reveal God's love, that was more important than his own safety. It was more special than even saving his own life. And so again, we are challenged to get things in perspective. We can't always avoid trouble and hardship. There are times when we have to face up to those things. We have to be willing to go through them, not for ourselves, but for the sake of someone else. Greater love has no one than this. To lay down one's life for one's friends.
Thank you.
The crowd said to Jesus,
"The scriptures teach that the Messiah will live forever. How can you say that the Son of Man will be lifted up?"
"Who is the Son of Man?"
Jesus answered, "The light will be with you for only a little longer. Walk in the light while you can. Then you won't be caught walking blindly in the dark. Have faith in the light while it is with you, and you will be children of the light."
After Jesus had said these things, he left and went into hiding. He had performed a lot of miracles among the people, but they were still not willing to have faith in him.
In this third and last section, John, the Gospel writer, returns to his recurring theme of light. At the beginning of the prologue, he talks about the light of the world coming. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has never put it out. And that is still his understanding and still what he wants to communicate at the end of the gospel, as the darkness seems to gather in around Jesus. How much easier it is to live life in the light, to live life if you know what is going on around you. It's much easier, for instance, to make the right decisions if you know all the facts. You will make much better relationships if they are open and honest. The light illuminates both literally and metaphorically. And so Jesus again issues a challenge to his followers. Live in the light while I am still with you. He knows the darkness is coming. He knows there will be a time when they are alone. He wants them to take these opportunities. And it is a challenge to faith, to our faith, to believe in the light and live as people of the light. To return once more to my analogy of the lovers, sometimes we can miss our chance. We have to say what we're thinking, what we're feeling, while the person is still there. Otherwise, we might miss the opportunity, that moment to declare our love. And it will be gone. And it may never come again. Jesus doesn't want his disciples to live with regrets. To look back and say, "Oh, if only we had taken that opportunity." He wants them to be able to look back and say, "Well, we took a risk with Jesus, but it was worthwhile. Even if that caused us some suffering, look at the reward that we've got." That is the very nature of passion. To grab at life with enthusiasm, with energy, with expectation. Yes, it might sometimes go wrong, but if we never try, we will never know what possibilities there have been there, right in front of us. I do wonder sometimes if Jesus had regrets. I'm sure he had disappointments, not least about other people and the way that they deprived themselves of the chance of salvation, walking away from him, not being prepared to grab the opportunity as it was presented to them. But I wonder if Jesus felt that in some ways, at some times, he had failed. I think he must, otherwise he wouldn't have been truly human. But what was important, and what remains so to this day, is the fact that he tried. He tried to show people a new, a better way of life, in his words and in his actions. And through that, he gave us a new life, life eternal. So when, over the next couple of weeks, as we follow Jesus on the Via Dolorosa, the way of the cross, let us accompany him to Calvary and the empty tomb, knowing that for him and for us, it is not the way of death, but the way to life itself. Let us have courage to shoulder that cross and walk beside him. Amen.
We offer our prayers of intercession, and during these prayers there will be a time of silence after each bidding. Let us pray. God of our salvation, we remember at this time how our Lord Jesus Christ faced suffering and death, that the glory of your love might be revealed and draw all the world to you. And so we pray for those who face suffering. We bring to you, compassionate God, those who are ill, perhaps dreading what the future may hold, or undergoing painful treatment, or frustrated by the limitations their illness imposes. In silence, we pray for them. God with us in the darkness of suffering, may the glory of your love be revealed. We bring to you, compassionate God, those who are in need, the homeless, the hungry and malnourished, the lonely and unloved. In silence, we pray for them. God with us in the darkness of suffering. May the glory of your love be revealed. We bring to you, compassionate God, those who grieve, those who watch over the dying, the recently bereaved, and in silence we pray for them. God with us in the darkness of suffering, may the glory of your love be revealed. We bring to you, compassionate God, those needing forgiveness. Some eaten up by guilt, others burdened with empty lives, or unable to love. In silence we pray for them. God with us in the darkness of suffering, may the glory of your love be revealed. We bring to you, compassionate God, our own suffering, our pain at falling short as your children, our pain at seeing the pain of others, our pain embraced in the name of love. God with us in the darkness of suffering, may the glory of your love be revealed. In the name of Jesus Christ, who by his sufferings has brought us wholeness and joy. Amen.
And we say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. An offering prayer. Jesus Christ, you gave everything for us, dying that we might live. We offer our gifts and ourselves, that through us and the work of your church, others may share in your risen life. Amen.
Thank you.
The light is still among us. Let us live in the light of Christ, to serve him with our lives and to glorify his name. And so may God, who makes all things new, transform our living, and the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us and with all whom we love, today and always. Amen.
So take yourself back 12 months, January, February, March last year. Mm-hmm. How did it feel for you and the chaplaincy team as you could sort of see the thing developing? Because obviously York was there at the beginning.
It was. Do you know, it's hard almost to look back because so much has happened. I can only begin to think it was like a storm that was gradually coming over us, that I almost thought it's probably going to pass us by. But then obviously it became more real. And I think the thing that we began to understand from a very, in a way, the first part of it was that the one thing that we'd been missing was relatives and visitors. I mean, we'd had that before in sort of a few weeks if there'd been a bad infection or whatever and that had been cancelled, but suddenly this was becoming real, that those people who were so loved of the patients might be missing. And as you begin to understand a little bit more, which just slowly leaped out, I can only describe it now, and I couldn't then, but I think almost what we've been through is the different stages of grief. And almost, perhaps the first stage of grief is very often disbelief. You know, this isn't real, it can't be happening. How can this be? And so I think very much in those first few months, that's what it felt like. And just not knowing, and of course, us, like anybody else, could not have envisaged for a minute how long it would last and just what it would entail. So I think probably as I look back now, I can see that very much this has been an unravelling of grief and continues to be. I think we'll always mourn in different ways for this time, but that in the very beginning, I think, was where we were. This just cannot be happening. How can this be? How is this going to work out? For our patients, for us as a chaplaincy, for the staff. And of course, it all felt very scary then because it was scary, but we just didn't understand really what the pandemic would be.
It's probably too early to ask, but I'm going to ask it anyway, because, you know, here we're looking back 12 months, and we're still not and nowhere near through to the end. But how do you think the experience will actually impact on the practice of chaplaincy as a hospital chaplain? What, you know, what sort of tools or what ideas do you think will carry forward for you?
I think we have ended up with more toolkits than we've had before. So very early on, it was very much that we did all our chaplaincy through the medium of going to see someone and being alongside them. I think that feels quite different now at the very beginning. And in fact, all the way through, we realised that we couldn't just, like everybody else in society, just go and visit someone. We actually had to think through, was that sensible? Was that the best? Actually, were we creating more problems, perhaps by, you know, we had to be careful of infection control. We had to be careful of our own selves because it would be daft to go unless, you know, it was actually safe as possible to do so. So very early on, our first reaction when we realised that A, our volunteers were just going to be stopped. So we had a huge amount of volunteers. We still do in the wings, you know, sort of up to 40, who were going to be stopped. So basically, we were left with just the full-time chaplains. And so we couldn't possibly be operating chaplaincy in the same way we were before. So in the very early days, and we've continued it through, we developed prayer packs. And we put together what we thought might be helpful for people, you know, who are in dire straits, whether that was just a little card to them from us with our numbers on, because of course a lot of people have mobile phones these days, and they have got prayer cards in. We had oodles of hearts were given to the hospital, she'd probably remember, so we might put a heart in. And we've had these most amazing throughout this crosses, which were made by York Community Church and are still making them to this day, where lots of, I understand the chaps, I don't think I'm doing chapesses, women are disabled, but they've generally been men in sheds who've gone in there, and they've made handheld crosses, and they've made them in pairs. So just a bit like the hearts, we were able to give one to the patient and then very often send one to the relatives. And were made in exactly the same wood, and those have just been beautiful. So we've relied a lot more on that, and of course we had Zoom. We did a lot more relative interaction than we ever had before, because of course we weren't getting the relatives by the bed. So to have somebody non-medical go and see a patient and then be able to ring them or talk to them seemed to be really important. And of course, the staff have become much more of our focus as well as time's gone on. So I think
the whole community.
So I think that way of doing chaplaincy in so many respects, I think will carry on. And I think we're going to have to think harder about the decision all the time. Is it sensible to go and see this patient? Which I think is probably a way that is safe to go down, really.
You mentioned the Holding Cross, and here we are on Passion Sunday. For the next 2 weeks, we're approaching remembering Jesus and the cross. Are there aspects of that experience of Jesus over these 2 weeks that you draw on, perhaps particularly in ministry at this time?
Yeah. In a way, it's felt like one long passion story. Of course, there have been resurrection moments. Of course, there has been signs of hope, and there is all the time in a hospital, despite the bad news that's gone on. I would liken it to last Easter. So we were just starting this, and remember writing in the chapel that actually Good Friday seems so much more poignant. And in so many ways, I feel like Resurrection Sunday never really came, and that we've been waiting for it to happen. And I think that's true for so many people who are staff, who have been patients, and of course so many people who ended up with long COVID or have lost people. And so it's made me personally learn to lament far more than I ever have done before. In a way, it's changed all of us. It's changed me personally as a chaplain. I think I've been very quick before to try and always, I'm quite an optimistic person by nature, and perhaps my theology was one that didn't want to always stay in lamentations. But I've actually found so much more that it's okay to live there and to stay there a while when we have no answers, when we struggle to find our way through this. And in a way, it's made me a little bit more available for the story of the Passion to actually think, what must it have been like? And there's a bit more understanding of those who stood and watched the cross and ran off. Because of course, with hindsight, we look back and we know as Christians, Resurrection Sunday happened. But actually, it's made me live a little bit more in the moment. And the moment perhaps has made it more real for those in that story who didn't know, perhaps wanted to believe but didn't really know when that resurrection, if ever, would happen, or would it just be the end. So I think that's a little bit about my reflections as we look on Passion Sunday. And yet I still, of course, as a Christian, hang on to the fact that there will be an Easter Sunday. And perhaps this year.
Thank you. Yeah, perhaps this year. That's good. Thank you.